Hi everyone, this is Mike at BrashMonkey, and this quick tip tutorial is going to help you avoid the most common beginner mistakes when using Spriter. The first thing I'm going to suggest you not do is something I've been guilty of many times in the past with other applications. Once you have Spriter installed, don't just start it up and expect to be able to start. There's actually several things you have to do in preparation for your first project. And before you begin your first project, I highly recommend you go into Spriter's menu and choose Help, and you'll see Spriter has a built-in manual, and I suggest you read through the Quick Start Guide. Another extremely useful resource you'll find in Spriter's Help section is Video Help, which will give you a direct link to two playlists of Spriter tutorials. The important thing you need to understand before starting a Spriter project is that Spriter is not an image editor. It's an animation tool that lets you manipulate images you've already created or acquired in order to create animations. So the first thing you would need to do when starting a Spriter project is to create a folder for your entire project, which you can name anything you'd like. And within that project folder, you would put subfolders to organize all of the images you'll be using to create and animate your character. Once your project folder is ready with some images inside that you can use to start animating, now you can go into Spriter, and the first thing you're going to do is choose File, New Project, and then you're going to choose that folder that you've just created as your project folder. But before you do start using any of these images, you should double-click on each of them to set a default pivot point in some sensible manner. Like, for instance, for heads, you would want to do something like the base of the skull area. And here's some other really important points to remember when creating and exporting your images for use in Spriter. The first thing is, make sure you do not draw your images directly onto what's typically called the background layer, which is solid and typically white. You need to work on a new layer so that you have usually what's a checkerboard pattern in the painting program, which means that there's transparency there. Another really important thing to keep in mind, you see this giant area of checkerboard around where I drew this head image. You don't want to waste all of this space in your Spriter project with these completely empty area. And how you crop exactly is going to be slightly different depending on the painting program, but you're probably going to find an icon something like this. Or just a rectangular selection tool. So then you're going to basically tell the program how to crop your image. And now you can see there's very little area of empty pixel around my image, and you would want to save all of your images cropped something more like this. They should be saved out as PNG images. And more importantly, make sure you're not creating images at an unnecessarily large resolution. If just the head alone of your character is thousands of pixels across, that's higher resolution than an entire game screen, even on a high-end console or PC. You're going to end up with graphic memory issues and things like that. If you ever have to add a new image while you're animating, all you have to do is find the appropriate folder, in this case, the head folder, in your Spriter project, and here you'll see I've created a new head image for when the character gets hurt. You just drag that into the appropriate folder, and then when you go back into Spriter, you click this little refresh button here, and now if I check the head folder, you'll see I have my new head image. Similarly, if you just have to edit an image, you just edit the image in your painting program of choice, save the image back out into the folder that it belongs into with the same name in the Spriter project, and then click this refresh image, and your updated image should appear to replace the old version of the image. Another really important thing to remember is make sure you fully assemble and rig your character at the zero point on the timeline, you'll see here, current time zero, before you've started animating anything and before there's any keyframes besides the one at zero in the timeline. Make sure your character is fully rigged and all proper images are assigned to the appropriate bones and move accordingly when you move the limbs. Also, while you're doing this, this is a great opportunity to check and troubleshoot and fix any issues with the Z order of the images relative to the body parts. You don't want to have to go back and mess with Z orders while you're animating if it's not necessary, once you have many keyframes going on. A common misconception by beginners using Spriter is that if you change the Z order or bone hierarchy at any point in your timeline once you begin animating, that these changes will go across the entire animation. But you'll see, if I put this head all the way to the back so it's strangely behind the neck here in this keyframe, if I scroll back to this keyframe, you'll see that the head is still in front of the torso image. Only once it reaches this other keyframe where I change the Z order does this new Z order take place. If you end up needing to change the Z order across the entire animation at some point, once you've fixed it in one keyframe, like here it's correct, you can choose Edit, Copy Z Order to Other Frames. In Spriter, not only can the Z order be different per frame of any animation, but so too can the actual objects or images that are in each keyframe of the animation. So for example, in this case, if I'm doing an animation to make this character shoot their pistol, I can actually add this muzzle flash exactly where I need it. So it actually does not exist until this point of the animation, and then it disappears at the next keyframe. If I need it to persist longer in the animation, I can select it and press Control C, and then go to the next keyframe and press V to paste it in there, and Spriter knows that it's the same object. And then the object can be deleted when it's no longer needed. So now you can see, when the flash image is required, it's now in the animation. And then once it finishes its animation and is no longer needed in the animation, it can be removed. If you've otherwise finished an animation but then discover you need to add something, don't drag and add the object from the file palette onto every keyframe of every animation. The way to do it is quite simple. You go to the first spot or zero on the timeline, and you drag out and add your object, scale it as needed. Let's say we're going to give this character a monocle. So we put that in place, and now we're going to want to assign this image to the same bone that moves the head. So we're going to select that head bone, hold B, and then left click on the monocle, and now that monocle is assigned to the same bone. You'll see if I move the head bone, the monocle moves with it. I'll undo that move. Now I'm going to make sure the monocle is selected and press Control C to copy, and then Control Shift V, as in Victor, which is going to paste, and that should paste that new monocle object across all keyframes. But not only does it paste it across all the keyframes, it also pastes its hierarchy, the fact that it's a child of that head bone, across all frames. Once you finish the first animation for a character, don't start from scratch for each new animation. What you can do is either clone your animation and edit it to create a new animation, or you can start a blank animation and then pick any part of any timeline for another animation of that character. For example, we'll just scroll to an arbitrary location in this floating animation where the character's floating in the water. Let's say this particular spot right here is something very similar to how I want my new animation to start. I just scrub through the timeline to find the spot I want to copy, press Control Shift C to copy, that copies everything in the frame, and then I go back to my new animation, make sure I'm at zero on the timeline, and press Control V, and that pastes the entire frame ready to go. And of course, as with any productivity program, as you make progress, save frequently, but don't just save frequently, back up to a whole new file name quite frequently as well. What I do is save the file with the date at the end of the file name, so that I know exactly where I'd be reverting back to in case of any trouble. And when you're saving, make sure you always save into the exact same project folder that you had selected in the first place when you created your new project. And be sure to never move that Spriter file that you've created to a different folder location relative to the image subfolders, because Spriter files don't actually save the images that they use internally. They just reference to those images. So if you delete those images or change the position of the Spriter file relative to the images, the next time you open that Spriter file, it's not going to be able to find those images for you. And one final problem that several beginners were having while exporting finished animations to animated GIF or sprite sheets, pay attention to whether or not you're using extremely high resolutions. And the other issue is frame rate, FPS. Keep in mind your average movie is traditionally 24 frames per second, and the higher quality walk cycle animations for classic console and arcade games were in the area of 8 to 12 frames for the entire walk loop. So if you run into these issues, try choosing a lower FPS than you're currently trying to export to, and double check your resolution, and if it's really high, try reducing the scale of your project, which is a built-in feature in Spriter Pro. You would choose Other File Actions, Save As Resize Project, and then you would decide your scale here. 1.0 is full size, 0.5 would be half the size, as you can see. And then you would choose save, and then you would load up that reduced size version of your project and try exporting that one. So that's it for this video. Thanks a lot for watching.